Hey everyone, it's Ariel Waldman with Tested. I'm really excited today because I wanted to talk to you all about a few of the expeditions I've been on and the cameras that have helped me on those expeditions. It's been a little while since we've said hi, so as a reminder, I've been on a lot of different scientific expeditions. In the last few years, I went on an expedition to Antarctica. I was going there to film the life under the ice in Antarctica. It was really fantastic, and I'm actually working on trying to go back, hopefully in about a year or so. And some of the other things I've done more recently, I actually went on a deep sea expedition with MBARI, the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute. I went on a 7-day deep sea expedition where we were looking for jellyfish and all these really cool creatures under the ocean. In fact, that's actually kind of what all of my expeditions are usually about. It's trying to find the invisible life in this world, the life that is, you know, either microscopic or deep under the ocean, things that we don't regularly see all the time, so that I can really show you all the amazing creatures that live in the world. I have a lot of really awesome trips and things that I go on, and to really get a sense of what they're like and really share that with all of you, I use a lot of different cameras for that. And so I wanted to share some of my favorite cameras and setups that I've been using to do this type of work. So with the DJI Pocket 2, this is the first one. I only got this recently. And I really love it because it's just this really great lightweight camera with a gimbal. And the gimbal is what's key for me, because when I was going on this meteor crater hike and I was going into this rough terrain in high altitude, hot weather, it was really difficult. And usually I have used a much larger iPhone gimbal, which actually I've got here. So this is the type of iPhone gimbal I typically use on my expeditions prior to a few months ago. And I use this on the deep sea expedition. I use this in Antarctica. It's a really great gimbal, but you know, it has some drawbacks, especially if you're doing scientific expedition types of work. It's really heavy. It's really bulky. Whenever I go places with it, it always impresses people. People always want to know how much it costs. These are actually pretty affordable, but it's really difficult to work with. So for instance, I was on this deep sea expedition a few months ago, and I was using this, and the ship is moving, and I'm trying to film all these cool jellyfish that we're bringing up from the deep, and I'm trying to do that while also helping out my team carry jars of water everywhere. And so I kept trying to stuff this gimbal into my backpack strap to try and move around so I could film and then help people. And it was just bulky. I ran into people. I ran into walls. It was really not great. So I've actually been hopeful to find something that's a little bit better than using this. But the problem, of course, has been, is there something that competes with the iPhone enough that I can get rid of this? So that's what I found with the DJI Pocket 2. It's lightweight. It gets around the whole iPhone gimbal issue, and it also is really good, and it's really been stepped up since the DJI Pocket 1. I had looked at the Pocket 1 a long time ago, and it just didn't seem like it was going to be as good. This has a larger sensor. It's better auto tracking and auto focus. It actually is able to track faces and then focus on those faces. So it has a lot of features that make it at least a bit better and closer to an iPhone. And why it was really great for me going on this meteor crater hike was that I was able to just clip it using a really simple clip to my backpack and actually then just hike and have this be hands-free and just recording 4K 60. And it worked really well. I was really impressed with it. And I think the DJI Pocket 2, I think, just ends up being a little modular thing that is really helpful. One of the things that it comes with is a little case, a little holster. And inside this holster, it has like a wide angle lens adapter. It also has a lightning cable adapter. And this means that if you get really frustrated with using this little postage stamp of a monitor on it, you can plug in your iPhone and get a much larger monitor. So it has a lot of capabilities that are kind of built into it that make it really nice and just easy to use. And it also has some really cool things if you're an explorer. So it also has an auto panoramic mode, and it also has an auto time-lapse mode. So what we actually did, my partner and I, he set up the DJI Pocket 2 when we were road tripping to this meteor crater, and he set it up to look at the stars and do some astrophotography. Both of us are not really well versed in astrophotography at all, but the DJI Pocket 2 makes it really, really easy to just set it up and get a time lapse of the sky, and it works beautifully. You can also do time lapses in motion, so you can get sort of that cool BBC documentary sort of feel where it's moving across a landscape and getting a time lapse at the same time. All right, so that's a lot of the work that I do when I'm out in rough terrain or in a helicopter or on a ship. I've been in a lot of different situations where things are just bouncy. You know, ships are, you know, constantly moving with the ocean. I get so motion sick, but, you know, the DJI helps me stabilize everything, even if I can't stabilize myself. But once I'm actually done doing, you know, the work out in the field and actually have some cool samples of microbes and want to look at them, this is my go-to microscope. This is the Nikon E200 microscope. It's an LED microscope, which is really important because I don't want to have to worry about having different bulbs breaking or things like that. This microscope I got on sale for around $1,500. It probably retailed for around $2,000. But if you want a microscope, you don't have to spend that much money to get a good microscope. You can get good microscopes anywhere between $100 to $500. You really don't have to spend this much to get a good microscope. For me, I just really like this Nikon because it has a lot of different features that I specifically need, one of which is a trinocular. So typically microscopes are either binocular, so you can look through the eyepieces, or they're trinocular so that you can actually attach a camera to it. And I really like that because microscopes often come sold with cameras attached, but it's kind of like buying a car. If you buy a car, then you're kind of stuck with whatever radio music system comes in that car, so it gets outdated pretty quickly. Whereas if you get trinocular, you can always attach either your DSLR or your mirrorless camera or what have you to the microscope and constantly keep it updated without being stuck to one camera system and one technology from a certain year. So this microscope I really love. It's just a really basic, simple microscope that it's just, I don't know, it's my favorite go-to microscope. I actually brought it with me to Antarctica. So I put it in a Pelican case. It came with me to Antarctica 5 weeks. I was using this all the time to film all sorts of microscopic critters. What I was using while I was in Antarctica was a combination of a Canon 5D Mark II, which actually Adam Savage himself loaned to me, which was really useful. And I also got a Canon 6D Mark II. And those had been my go-to cameras that I was attaching to this microscope for a while until my partner got a Canon R5 and it blew them out of the water. And I actually can only now use the R5 because getting all these really great details of all these little microbes and their little claws or their little cilia, little hairs and everything that move around. The R5's sensor is just so much better. It's able to get a much more dynamic range. So I think the 6D Mark II gets a dynamic range of 9 stops maybe. This one gets more like 14 stops. And it means that when I'm filming a lot of creatures and there's a lot of difference in the light, but I can actually like look at the details of these creatures really well. And it means I can go really, really dark and see things under fluorescence or different types of light and not have a lot of noise. So it means I can go into really high ISOs and not get all of the grainy noise that you would usually see in a camera. The R5 means that you can go really high up, really dark picture, and you still just don't see any noise. And that's been what's really killer for me. One of the downsides of the R5, though, is the fact that it overheats very easily when you're filming for an extended period of time, which is a known issue. Everyone knows the Canon R5, fantastic camera, but it has overheating issues. So the way a lot of people get around it and the way I get around it is by actually using the Atomos Ninja 5. And this is a recording device that a lot of filmmakers will be familiar with. It acts as both a monitor and a recorder. It means that you can actually record through the Ninja 5 instead of the Canon R5, and it means it won't overheat. So you can do extended filming of video. And for me, I'm often looking at tardigrades for hours, and I can just film them for hours, look at their behavior, and not have to worry because I run it all through the Ninja 5. And then finally, I actually tether it to my laptop using Canon's EOS utility software, and it means that I can use my laptop as a monitor, see all the cool tardigrades, see all the little critters, and monitor them through my laptop while recording through the Ninja 5. So the Canon R5 is really fantastic when I'm with my own microscope and I have my own setup and I kind of have a controlled situation. But a lot of times I'm in different people's labs or I'm using different types of microscopes. A really geeky thing about me is that I'm actually the president of the San Francisco Microscopical Society. Really geeky, fantastic group of microscope enthusiasts. So I'm always looking at different microscopes, but I want to always be recording cool stuff through them. And I don't always have my Canon R5 and a trinocular setup. It's all very specific to a specific device. So when I'm wanting to move from microscope to microscope, I actually use the LabCam with iPhone. And this is something I've talked about in my favorite things videos before, but I still use it all the time. It's only for iPhone, which I know a lot of people will be disappointed about, but it's really fantastic. And why it's so great is that it actually plugs into the binoculars of any microscope. And it does this through having machined metal. And this is why it's so much better than getting something that's 3D printed. A lot of times 3D printed microscope adapters, they do enough, but they're not really precision. This has machined metal, which means that when you slot it into a binocular, it just perfectly slots in. There's about two different sizes of microscope binoculars that are pretty standard across almost all brands. And this comes with those two standard eyepieces. So it means that I can just go into any lab and instantly have the confidence knowing that I have an iPhone that I can film cool critters or all sorts of cool stuff under the microscope with. So that's kind of my go-to thing when I'm going to Antarctica, when I'm going on a ship, when I'm going kind of anywhere to anyone's lab or anything like that. It's really useful. So that's some of the gear that I really enjoy using. I've used all sorts of gear all over the world. I hope you've enjoyed a lot of the footage that I've shared. I've got more on my own channel. I love coming here on Tested and sharing all the gear that helps enable all of that footage to be shot. It's just a lot of fun. If you haven't already, maybe consider getting a microscope and exploring in your own backyard. You don't need an expensive microscope and you don't need to go to Antarctica to look at tardigrades. In fact, I actually filmed a how to find tardigrades in your own backyard video for Tested that you can check out. And there's all sorts of fun things that you can do with all sorts of camera equipment. So thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.